640, the Tang Dynasty is nearly a quarter of a century old and reaching its heyday. The Turkic people to the north pledge allegiance, and the Tang cavalry asserts the empire's authority to the west. In the years after the collapse of the Han Empire, caravans have difficulty traveling between China and Central Asia. The Tang Empire sets out to restore order along the Silk Road. Xuanzang remains in India. After 14 years, he now longs to return to the Tang Empire as soon as possible. Xuanzang transforms from a foreign student in Nalanda to a well-known and respected monk. After his successful scripture debates, he's widely known in India. He's preparing to return to China when a letter of invitation arrives in Nalanda. The king of an eastern region of India is summoning him. Nalanda rejects the invitation on the grounds that Xuanzang will soon return to China. Xuanzang's biography records that the king is outraged over the rejection of his invitation. "I'm an ordinary person indulged in worldly pleasure. I have heard about this Chinese monk and want to learn about Buddhism. If he doesn't come, I will destroy Nalanda." The threat by the king to attack Nalanda prompts Xuanzang to postpone his journey home. Then, another prestigious leader summons him. These two powerful rulers are locked in a dispute, and war seems inevitable. Harsha is thought of as comparable to the great Indian leader Ashoka of the Maurya Empire. The great Tang records of the western region say he is a king by the age of 17. Within 6 years, his army is large and involved in nearly continuous battles. In the year 612, he has unified most of India and rules over the empire of Harsha. The center of Harsha's empire is on the middle reaches of the Ganges River. His capital is in central India. He becomes a powerful emperor, yet is benevolent as well as tolerant regarding religion. His support helps Buddhism survive. The king's generosity means the 10,000 or more people at Nalanda live comfortable lives. In the winter of 640, he and the king of eastern India are embroiled in a standoff over Xuanzang. Because of the powerful army and awe-inspiring reputation of Harsha, the King of Eastern India eventually capitulates. Xuanzang's biography says Harsha is eager to meet him and welcomes him at night. Thousands of torches light up the Ganges River, and hundreds of bronze drums sound along its banks. This was the guard of honor unique to Harsha, symbolizing the leader's supreme power in India. Harsha makes a surprising announcement. He will sponsor a nationwide religious debate. The debate is to take place in the capital. Xuanzang will play a major role in the debate, while Harsha will chair the exchange of ideas. Wise men and eminent monks of different sects in India will be compelled to take part and offer their thoughts on Xuanzang's ideas and opinions. The event may well be the largest religious debate in the history of India. Harsha and the King of Eastern India and another 18 kings were present. Over 3,000 monks attended the debate. More than 2,000 eminent representatives of Hinduism and other religions took part. Over 1,000 monks and others from Nalanda came. It brought together all the eminent members of the religious circles in India. Those present were either knowledgeable or eloquent, or both. The capital became crowded with people. After the opening rituals, Xuanzang begins a discourse on his ideas. The rules of the debate contain a system of rewards and penalties. Xuanzang says that if someone totally refutes his concepts, he will kill himself as a penalty. No one expects that he does not leave a way out for himself. Harsha has Xuanzang's beliefs put in writing, and the copies hang outside the debating chamber for opponents to study them. Harsha's beautiful younger sister believes in Buddhism. It's through her influence that Harsha gradually becomes interested in Buddhism. The emperor's younger sister had great wisdom and knew a lot about Samkhya. Samkhya is part of the Hinayana system of Buddhist beliefs. It consists of many sects that dispute each other. Buddhism is divided into Mahayana and Hinayana, and each has many sects. Xuanzang's beliefs belong to the Mahayana tradition. Influenced by him, the princess converts from Hinayana to Mahayana. Some of Xuanzang's opponents are eminent monks of Hinayana, and there are scholars from other religions. Xuanzang speaks with eloquence, waiting to be challenged. One day passes, but no one challenges him. 42-year-old Xuanzang indeed has a great deal of Buddhist knowledge. He begins learning at the age of 10 and visits Chinese monks during his youth. In the 15 years of his pilgrimage, he studies Buddhist classics unceasingly. He also has a gift for languages and personal charisma. All these qualities make him a genuine master of Buddhism. Five days pass, but he still awaits a challenge. No one has an inkling that a great danger is looming. On the night of the fifth day, a fire breaks out and the door of the meeting place burns. It's an act of sabotage. Harsha's respect for Xuanzang irritates followers of other religions. They won't challenge Xuanzang in debate, so they vent their anger in this manner.
Panjaskanta, Danshja, Svabhava Shunyan Pashyadisma.
The debate continues for 18 days without a challenger coming forward. Xuanzang's biography says that by the last day of the debate, his concepts have converted many people. He's praised as a master by followers of Hinayana and Mahayana Buddhism. Legend has it that many temples in India hang up replicas of Xuanzang's hemp shoes and decorate them with iridescent clouds. This legendary debate pushes his life in India to a peak. From the moment he first sees the Indus River to the time of the debate, 14 years pass. During this time, he grows from a student to a master and earns the respect of an emperor. This gifted religious pilgrim from China rises to great prominence on foreign soil, an unprecedented achievement. Xuanzang writes a page in the history of cultural exchanges between India and China. Later that year, Harsha sends envoys to the Tang Empire. Envoys of the Tang also come to India and are warmly received. It's the first time China and India exchange diplomatic envoys. History records say the contact between the Tang and India lasts for half a century. Chinese people learn from India the method of refining white sugar. The medical sciences of India, especially methods of curing eye diseases, are introduced to China. Xuanzang continues to collect the original manuscripts of Buddhist classics, as he had done since the beginning of his pilgrimage. They are to have a huge influence on Buddhism in China. Spring of the year 641, Xuanzang finally leaves India for China. Saying goodbye is difficult. Both Harsha and the monks of Nalanda are reluctant to see him go. Xuanzang knows he will never have a chance to return to India. Buddhism Buddhism in India flourishes in line with the support of emperors. In the 3rd century BC, Ashoka of the Maurya Empire believes in Buddhism and spreads it through India on a large scale. In the 1st century, the support of the Kushan Empire allows Buddhism to reach its pinnacle and begin to spread to other countries. Around the 4th century, it shows signs of going into decline. In the 7th century, with the support of Harsha, Buddhism experiences a temporary brilliance. But the decline of Buddhism will prove to be irreversible. Around the 12th century, invaders from the steppes of Central Asia destroy Nalanda, India's last great center of Buddhism. Though it's the home of Buddhist philosophy and teaching for 8 centuries, it cannot hold back the flames of war. The destruction of Nalanda marks the demise of Buddhism in India. It's an important part of life in this country for over 1,000 years, but it gradually disappears into the depths of history, leaving behind few traces. The people of ancient India create a brilliant civilization, but are not fond of recording history. Except for myth and legends, there is little written of their real lives. The history of ancient India is shrouded in mystery. During his 14 years in India, Xuanzang travels to every single corner of the country. Later, he puts what he saw into the book, Great Tang Records of the Western Regions. Chinese scholars say its rich content and detailed descriptions make it a significant history book. This book is a guide for Alexander Cunningham during his archaeological excavations. For more than 6 centuries, Nalanda decays and the site is overgrown by forest. In 1861, Alexander Cunningham uncovers the ruins of Nalanda, and this cultural center of ancient India reawakens. A British historian comments that it's no exaggeration to say Xuanzang's influence on the history of India is second to none. Indian historians say that without Xuanzang's book, it would have been impossible to retrieve the history of ancient India. Great Tang Records of the Western Regions illuminates the history of medieval India. As summer approaches, Xuanzang leaves India and embarks on his journey back to China. He's a solo traveler as he departs Chang'an, but is accompanied by a team of followers when he returns. He has a large number of Buddhist books and scriptures. His biography says as they cross the Indus River, disaster strikes. When we reached the middle of the river, our boats almost turned over in the strong current. The man guarding the books fell into the river, and we made great efforts to save him. But 50 books and seeds of exotic flowers and fruit dropped into the water. In the novel, Journey to the West, Xuanzang experiences 81 disasters on his journey. Losing the books in the river is the last one. The novel, though based on Xuanzang's pilgrimage, is far from historically accurate. The last disaster, though, is consistent with the facts. After crossing the Indus River, Xuanzang must pass through mountains to reach the Pamir Plateau once again. We trekked for 7 days on rugged paths before reaching the mountain pass. The way was too rugged for horses, so we could only move forward supported by walking sticks. We trekked for another 7 days and then reached the highest peak. Beneath it was a village of about 100 homes. The sheep they raised were as big as donkeys. The cliffs were covered with ice and snow. Any carelessness might cost us our lives. So we got a local villager to be our guide. We didn't go through the pass until dawn. We went downhill the following day. Another peak covered by cloud came into view. We reached the summit. At dusk, the wind was piercing and there were no birds. No one could stand up straight. Xuanzang faces the highest mountain he will encounter on his journey. It's within what is now the country of Afghanistan. His journey to India follows the middle route of the Silk Road. 17 years later, he returns to his homeland along the southern route, which is expected to save him time. In 643, more than a year after leaving India, Xuanzang is preparing to climb to the Pamir Plateau. Beyond the mountains is the road to the western regions. He's getting nearer to the border of the Tang Empire. In the summer of the year 643, Xuanzang is crossing the Pamir Plateau on the journey home. As he leaves India, he rejects an offer to travel by ship, which would have been faster and far less arduous. Instead, he chooses to return overland. 17 years earlier, he had made a promise that he intends to keep. Early in his pilgrimage, as he's alone in the desert and uncertain if he will ever see India, Xuanzang reaches Gaochang, where a king becomes his patron and provides support. He rejects the demand to stay and be an advisor, but Xuanzang promises that on his way back, he will stop and teach in Kaohsiung for 3 years. After walking in the gorge for over 350 kilometers, we reached the Bomilo Valley. It was 500 kilometers from east to west, and over 50 kilometers from south to north. The narrowest part was less than 5 kilometers wide. Xuanzang is the first to describe the Pamir Plateau in writing. The ancient Chinese call this place Chongling Mountains. Beyond is the distant Western world. For travelers, there was an important pass that would take them across the forbidding mountains. It's believed that the Bomilo Valley Xuanzang refers to as Wakhan Corridor near the junction of Afghanistan, Pakistan, and China. For over 1,000 years, it's an important passageway on the southern route of the Silk Road. In 2005, 83-year-old Professor Fang Chiyong visits the Pamir Plateau for the third time. Combining Xuanzang's descriptions with his own explorations, he believes that Xuanzang enters China from Mintaka Pass. Tong records of the western region say that a large group of tradesmen were frozen to death in Mintaka Pass when they became trapped by a snowstorm. Over 1,300 years ago, Xuanzang crosses the 4,700 meter high pass and enters the western regions. Kabanda Kingdom is today's Tashkurgan County in China. Xuanzang records the legend of a beautiful Chinese princess stopping here on her way to marry a Persian prince. It was a time of war, and her escorts built a fortress on the mountain. Traces can still be found today. A river runs through a high mountain valley where weary travelers find shelter in a stone fortress. Tashkurgan means the stone city. These ruins are on the site of the capital of the Kabanda Kingdom. Huge stones are scattered around the remains of the ancient city. Temples and government offices are still vaguely visible. Xuanzang stays in Tashkurgan for more than 20 days. Not long after leaving, he encounters robbers. According to Great Tong records of the western regions, public order in this area is not well kept. The local people were irritable and violent. They often cheated, and some even robbed travelers openly. Xuanzang continues along the often dangerous route, enduring snowstorms as he crosses the rugged Pamir Plateau. reaches Kashgar and hears the sad news about his sworn brother and his kingdom. A merchant from Gaochong tells him that the king has passed away and the land is now part of the Tang Empire. Three years earlier, while Xuanzang is still in India, relations between Gaochong and the Tang dynasty reach an impasse. The new king of Gaochong, Chu Wentai, allies himself with the Turkic people against the Tang Empire to control the Silk Road. Chu believes the desert is an insurmountable barrier, but Chinese cavalry easily cross it. Chu realizes he's made a fatal mistake and his kingdom is doomed. The history records say he passes away in the royal palace in panic, and his kingdom surrenders without a fight. The king had passed away, and the agreement we had made was something that would never take place. I would return to the Tang Empire directly via the southern route of the Silk Road. Xuanzang's team heads south across a vast desert. In the winter of 643, Xuanzang reaches the famous Buddhist kingdom of Khotan. He's warmly received, but feels uneasy. Before stepping onto Chinese soil, he hopes to gain the forgiveness of the emperor. "17 years ago, I ignored your majesty's order and left the country without permission. I crossed deserts and mountains. I traveled for over 25,000 kilometers. Though I ran into many difficulties, I didn't encounter any big obstacles, thanks to your majesty's prestige." Xuanzang writes a letter to the emperor Taizong. He admits to making a mistake and then attributes the success of his pilgrimage to Taizong. His experience over the previous 17 years makes him aware of the importance of maintaining good relations with rulers. While waiting in Khotan, Xuanzang records the customs of the kingdom. "About 80 kilometers to the west of its capital, there were some mounds which zigzagged across the desert. According to the local people, here were some tombs of dead mice that passers-by were compelled to visit and worship." Xuanzang writes that the ancient people of Khotan worship mice, something that sounds very unlikely. In the year 1900, Mark Oral Stein discovers a piece of wood in an abandoned temple in Khotan. It has an illustration on it which contains a figure with the head of a mouse and a human body. It's wearing a crown. Stein believes this is the Mouse King recorded by Xuanzang. The Great Tang Records of the Western Regions has a beautiful story about how a group of mice saved Khotan during a battle. Stein credits Xuanzang with helping him to understand the image on the board. In the early 20th century, the book, Great Tang Records of the Western Regions, serves as a guide for European explorers. In the desert near ancient Khotan, Stein discovers a large number of cultural relics in ruins covered by sand. Today, they are in the British Museum. Xuanzang sorts the Buddhist sutras and sculptures in Khotan and does research while awaiting news from the Tang court. Khotan is a Buddhist kingdom, with India on the other side of the Pamir Plateau. Historians believe it was the first kingdom in the western regions to embrace Buddhism. Xuanzang describes three famous specialties of Khotan: carpets, jade, and silk. They are still produced in Khotan. Over 1,300 years later, people still weave carpets by hand, and Khotan jade is just as priceless. The name Yumen Pass, or Jade Gate Pass, a famous gateway on the Silk Road, comes from the local jade. Xuanzang records a legend about the origin of silk in Khotan. The story goes that a princess from an eastern kingdom hid a silkworm egg, deceived the guards, and brought it into Khotan. A part of a woodcut discovered by Stein in 1900 seems to confirm Xuanzang's writings. Stein explains that a maiden points to the princess's hair bun, indicating where the silkworm egg is hidden. The basket in the middle contained the silkworm cocoon. In Stein's eyes, Xuanzang was both his guide and spiritual idol. Xuanzang suffers mental anguish while waiting in Khotan. Six months later, an envoy from Chang'an finally arrives with the reply from the Emperor Taizong. Xuanzang is surprised to learn the emperor is not enraged over his illegal departure. Instead, he's arranged the rest of the return journey for him. In the summer of 644, Xuanzang is about to leave for Chang'an. In the desert to the east of Nia was unpredictable winds and quicksand. There was no water or grass. No footprints would be left after someone walked by. Travelers could easily get lost. After leaving Khotan, he goes along the southern edge of the Taklamakan Desert. One after another, he passes through places that once held legendary oasis kingdoms. In Xuanzang's time, only barren desert remains. There were no paths across the sand. Passersby could only use the skeletons of the dead as road signs. The city of Lowland lay in ruins. It was desolate and uninhabited. After they leave the remnants of the Lowland Kingdom, signs of life begin to appear. Trees grow at the fringe of the desert. Xuanzang is now on the new territory of the Tang Empire. Dunhuang is just ahead, and the officials who will receive him are on their way. In later centuries, Dunhuang will be where Stein's exploration reaches a peak. He tricks a Taoist priest, Wang Yanlu, out of a large number of cultural relics on the pretext of doing research into Xuanzang. In his book, Stein records in detail how he won Wang's trust. As long as I talked about Xuanzang with them, no matter whether they were scholars or illiterate persons, our conversation would go smoothly. Xuanzang had always been my patron saint in China. Wang obviously liked to talk about him with me. In an environment full of Buddhist statues, I told him about my veneration for Xuanzang. I described the customs along Xuanzang's journey as specifically as possible. The expression in his eyes showed that he was fascinated by this. In the 20th century, a large number of Chinese cultural relics were removed from China. The events that took place at the Sutra Cave in Dunhuang are widely known. Stein took more than 10,000 Buddhist books, 500 paintings, and 230 bundles of manuscripts from the grottos in Dunhuang over 37 nights. It is hard to believe that this plunder was carried out in the name of Xuanzang. When we left Wang's cave after a busy day, I talked with him about our common idol. I claimed that I was the embodiment of Xuanzang's soul, and that Xuanzang had asked me to take away this large number of relics because they might have been related to his pilgrimage to India. Xuanzang reaches Dunhuang in the autumn of the year 644. Today, tourists come to visit its Buddhist grottos. Some of the murals here are also connected with Xuanzang. Stein's records say pious monks once made sculptures of Xuanzang here. The biography of Xuanzang shows that he didn't stay here for very long, as he had to meet the Tang Emperor as soon as possible. Early in the year of 645, Xuanzang finally returns to Chang'an. He reaches the capital of the now powerful Tang Empire sooner than expected, forcing surprised officials to scramble to welcome him. The news of his return spreads throughout Chang'an, and the streets fill with people. Nearly two decades earlier, a young monk seizes his chance to leave the city during a famine. Now, Chang'an is prosperous, and the monk has grown to a middle-aged and eminent religious scholar. The following day, the Prime Minister of the Tang Empire presides over a grand ceremony to welcome Xuanzang. The pilgrim to India is home, and he carries 657 Buddhist scriptures, 150 Sharira, and 7 valuable Buddhist sculptures. His quest takes him across 110 countries and spans 19 years, but he brings back great spiritual wealth to the Tang Empire and future generations of Chinese Buddhists. This is an important day in the history of China. But the main character of the story, Xuanzang, does not attend the ceremony. Instead, he remains in his room alone. After the hardship and joy of his pilgrimage, he knows this moment of glory might waste all of his efforts. His pilgrimage is at an end, but his real work is beginning. Hundreds of kilometers away in Luoyang, a man waits for him. This man will decide Xuanzang's future.